Welcome back to the program. Well, a decade ago, she became Australia's first female Prime Minister, and in her 3 years in the top job, she delivered some of the most iconic political moments in our history.
History has been made today here in Canberra. Julia Gillard is our first female Prime Minister.
I will not be lectured about sexism and misogyny by this man. I will not. If he wants to know what misogyny looks like in modern Australia, he doesn't need a motion in the House of Representatives. He needs a mirror.
There will be a ballot for the leadership and deputy leadership of the Labor Party at 4:30 today. In the meantime, take your best shot. If there is a girl at home who's watching this show tonight and thinks to herself, even for one fleeting moment, maybe in the future I could do that, that'd be nice. Rain on me.
Oh, it makes us nostalgic.
It does, doesn't it? And we're so happy to say that Julia Gillard joins us now. Julia, very good morning to you.
Good morning. Great to be with you.
And can we say well done on being the only former Prime Minister to leave politics and not meddle?
Yeah.
Why do you think it's so hard for the others just to zip it?
Oh, look, I don't know about the perspective of others, but what I can say for myself is I made a decision when I left that I would write what is now my first book, my story about my time in politics, and then it was done and it was time to do something else. And I found great things to do on women's leadership, on education, now with the Wellcome Trust, on health and medical research. So lots of great things to do.
You've always been incredibly classy in regards to that stuff. How do you feel we as a nation have gone in handling the COVID crisis? And I know Victoria is the centre of things at the moment, and Dan Andrews. I mean, how do you think our leadership has handled things?
Overall, I think we should be saying to ourselves as Australians that we've done very well in this pandemic. I came back from London in mid-March, and I'd have to say I've never been happier to feel those wheels go down on a tarmac at an Australian airport. I knew that this would be a great place to be while the world was in this kind of crisis. And it's not easy, and there will be occasional errors made, but I've been really impressed to see the spirit of bipartisanship that has had Conservatives and Labor leaders across the country working together in the interests of the community. So, you know, I take my hat off to that. It's fantastic. Mm.
Julia, do you miss politics at all?
I miss some bits of it, yes. I mean, I went into politics to make a difference, you know, to get big things done, and I'll never have more power in my hands than I had in those days to do the things that I believe in and put them into action. But you do need to think, you know, you don't want the rest of your life to be about looking back. You've got to look forward. And one thing that's really precious to me now is encouraging more women to go into politics and to aim for leadership, whether that be in business or the law or civil society or the news media or technology, which has brought me to writing this book on women and leadership. It really is a guide to help women and men think about how we could seize a more gender equal future. There are small things we can all do that would make a huge difference.
Why would any young woman want to go into politics when they saw how you were treated?
Because it's an incredible privilege to get to lead your nation, and if there is something that you passionately believe in that you want to see done, then there is no better way of making that happen than going into politics. So the message of this book, which is Women and Leadership, Real Lives, Real Lessons, is go for it, absolutely go for it. But be aware that there are still gendered bits, there are still times that you will be treated differently because you're a woman, and think about those in advance. You know, forewarned is forearmed. I wish I'd had a book like this when I was starting out.
Do you know, we had so much to do with you. As you know, it's been many, many years we had working together on this program with you going up against Tony Abbott. And I saw you go from in opposition to in government, and then you became the Prime Minister. And we all marvelled at your strength. But even to get to that point, we also watched how it looked like it was breaking you because of the disloyalty, because of the politics of politics. I mean, what an awful business.
I thought for a second then, Carl, you were going to say the only way to become Prime Minister in this country is to be a regular on the Today Show.
Well,
I thought that's
true.
Where you were going with that.
What he was hinting at.
Given there were all those years and I turned up every Friday morning to debate Tony Abbott, and that's a lesson on women and leadership. I'd turn up 40 minutes early to get hair and makeup done and he'd saunter in with 40 seconds to go. You'd probably remember that.
Yeah.
But yes, there were the difficult times. I'm not trying to say, look, it's all upside. There are hugely stressing moments. Mm. There's a relentlessness about politics. Mm. There's the criticisms. And we're never going to take all of that out of the system. But what I think we can take out of the system is the differential treatment of men and women. Mm. So people of merit, doesn't matter whether you're a man or a woman, people of merit get to come through without artificial barriers in their way.
Mm. Well, in your new book, you speak to other female leaders. You speak to Hillary Clinton, Jacinda Ardern and Theresa May. How do you think their experiences differed to yours? I know that Jacinda Ardern has said that she doesn't feel she faced those same challenges as you. Perhaps you and Hillary had a little bit more in common?
Yeah, Jacinda Ardern was really interesting to speak to. I mean, she's a wonderful woman, so of course it was a great conversation. But she was also incredibly clear that being the third female Prime Minister of her nation means it's a different experience. There was Jenny Shipley, and then for a long period of time, Helen Clark, and now Jacinda. And New Zealand is actually one of only two nations in the world that have had three women lead. The other one is Iceland. And it's only 13 nations in the world that have had more than one woman lead. And so it really reinforced in me that if we can make it more and more routine for women to come to the top, then the differential treatment ends up getting out of the system. You know, being number three, four, five, six is different from being the first. And that's what I want to see in this country, you know, before I shuffle off into whatever is after this life. I'd like to make sure that there are lots of women who get to the top and get to lead.
OK, your iconic misogyny speech went viral at the time and again recently in TikTok. Look at this.
The Leader of the Opposition says that people who hold sexist views and who are misogynist are not appropriate for high office. Well, I hope the Leader of the Opposition has got a piece of paper and he is writing out his resignation. Because if he wants to know what misogyny looks like in modern Australia, he doesn't need a motion in the House of Representatives. He needs a mirror.
I'm a bitch. I'm a bitch.
Yeah! What did you think of that?
Well, I distinctly remember getting text messages from people saying misogyny speech, TikTok, and then I had to reply, what's TikTok? And when I'd worked that out and had a look at it, I was kind of pleased and proud to see that it's got a new life. And if young women are using it as a bit of an anthem to get out the door and to hold their heads up high, that makes me feel very proud.
It's an anthem and it's an inspiration. Julie Gillard, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Your new book is called Women and Leadership, Real Lives, Real Lessons, and it is out today. As you said, Carl, classy.
And it's a great legacy. And my daughter, if one day she wanted to be Prime Minister, Julia has done it, has carved the path, and she has set the bar very high. So good on her.
Yeah, I just feel that so much of the attention at that time was on, I mean, here she was ruling with a minority government that got more legislation through than pretty much any other leader in modern times, yet so much of the focus was on peripheral stuff.
It's like politics,
looks,
isn't it?
No, but stuff that the men don't have to put up with, looks and what she's wearing, they haven't put up
with
that.
That's a good point.